So in a previous slide, you've seen that the integers form a group under addition. So remember that the integers are the whole numbers. So things like negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. All negative whole numbers, 0, and the positive whole numbers. And we see that this was a set of integers was a group under addition. You can take any two integers and add them, and you get another integer. The identity element we saw was 0, because if you take any integer and add 0, then this is just the same thing as the integer a. A plus 0 is 0 plus A equals A for any integer A. 5 plus 0 is 5. 6 plus 0 is 6. Negative 3 plus 0 is negative 3. So it's the identity element. Every element had an inverse, which was just its negative. The inverse of A is negative A. So for example, the inverse of negative 3 is negative, negative 3. The two negatives cancel out and we just get 3. And so remember what inverse meant. Inverse came from the fact that if you take A and add to it negative A, you get the identity for the group, namely 0. So same way, negative 3 plus its inverse, which is 3, is 0. And then finally we saw that this operation of addition on the integers was associative. Namely, if you took A plus B plus C and compare it to A plus quantity B plus C, it gives you the same thing. So just as a quick example, 1 plus 2 plus 5 versus 1 plus 2 plus 5. Let's think about that. Well, on the left side, we add 1 plus 2 first, so this gives us 3, and so we're taking 3 plus 5, which is 8. And on the right side, we're adding 2 plus 5 here first, that's 7, so the result is 1 plus 7, which is 8. So no matter what three numbers we try to take, we can add them and get that. And in fact, another important thing to mention about the integers under addition is this is a commutative group. That is, A plus B is the same thing as B plus A. It doesn't matter what order you add the numbers in. Compare this to what happened when we looked at the set of symmetries of the square. In that case, that was a non-commutative group. We saw that if you did two symmetries in a row, the answer that you got depended upon the order in which you did them. So if you did, I think we did this example of we did R times V versus V times R. Namely, you first do 90 degree clockwise rotation, and then you do a reflection about the vertical axis. And that gave us one answer. I believe that was D2. And if you went in the other direction, you did V times R, so you did reflection across the vertical axis first, followed by 90 degree clockwise rotation, I believe we got D1, and so the answers were different when you change the order. Here, though, that doesn't happen. 5 plus 3 is the same thing as 3 plus 5. So this is an example of a commutative group where the operation doesn't care in what order you combine two things. Suppose we wanted to look at a very related example. Suppose we wanted to look at the integers again, but now under multiplication. We know we can combine two integers under addition to get another integer, but we can also take two integers and multiply them together to get another integer. Any two whole numbers, take their product, you get another whole number. So for example, negative 3 times 2 is negative 6. And so we might ask, does this form a group? Namely, does a set of integers form a group under multiplication? Well, let's think about it. So first of all, is multiplication associative? on the integers. So namely, if I have any three integers, A, B, and C, and I look at those two different products, namely on the left side multiply A and B first, and then multiply it with C, on the right side multiply B and C first, and then multiply with A, are those the same? And the answer is yes. Just as an example, suppose we take 2 times 3 times 4 versus 2 times 3 times 4. 2 times 3 is 6. 6 times 4 is 24. On the other side, 3 times 4 is 12. And so we'd get 2 times 12, it's also 24. So in fact, it is true that no matter which three numbers, A, B, and C, you take, multiplication is associative. What about the identity? What would be the identity element for multiplication? Well, remember what the identity is supposed to be. It's supposed to be some integer, such when you multiply, such that if you take any integer A, it's something you can multiply by A to get to itself. So namely, what can I multiply with A to get A back? Well, that's easy. 1. 1 is an integer, it's a whole number. And we have the property that A times 1 is the same as 1 times A, which is just A. So for example, negative 3 times 1 is negative 3. So 1 is the identity. And so finally, there's just one more axiom to verify, which is, what is the inverse of an integer? And now remember, this depends upon our operation. We've already seen that for the operation of addition, the inverse of an integer was its negative. The inverse of 5 was negative 5. But that is for the operation of addition. Here we're looking at a different operation. We're looking at the operation of multiplication. So we want to know what's the inverse of an integer with respect to multiplication. So let's take, say, 5. What we want to know is, what do we multiply by 5 to get the identity? You know, if we're looking at the integers under multiplication, we said the identity should be 1. So we're asking 5 times what equals 1? For the moment, let's call this mystery number x. So you've seen equations like this before in algebra, and you've actually seen how to solve them. We just divide by 5 on both sides, and we'd get x equals 1/5. But notice, this is not an integer. 1 over 5 is not an integer. It's not a whole number. It's a fraction. So it's true that 5 has an inverse, but the resulting inverse is not an integer. So in this case, what we've seen is the integers under multiplication, the multiplication operation is associative, there's an identity element, but elements don't necessarily have inverses. 5, for example, does not have an integer inverse with respect to multiplication, because the inverse would have to be a fraction. The integers with respect to multiplication is not a group. Right? It looked like it was going to satisfy all the axioms, but when we went to satisfy the axiom of, does every element have an inverse, we saw that no. In fact, most elements don't. 5 doesn't have an inverse. 3, negative 2, 18, 460,000, right? Almost every single thing in the group does not have an inverse. So this is not a group.